And I support this bill hugely. And Honourable Minister, please take up our case.
Thank you. Maniye Nadimul Haq ji. Please. 1 minute, point of order.
Sub point 5 says you cannot reflect upon the conduct of persons in high authority unless the discussion is based on a substantive motion drawn on paper, drawn in proper terms.
Right.
And while speaking, Member Shakti Singh Gohil made certain observations against the former Chief Minister and current Prime Minister, and this was not even relevant to the subject at hand. Therefore, I request you to expunge. I request all those remarks which are irrelevant, which are in the nature of an allegation, should be removed from the records.
We'll look into your point of order. Honorable Sri Muhammad Nadimul Haq ji.
Thank you, Deputy Chairman sir, for giving me this opportunity to speak on the bill. I would like to take this opportunity to point out a few problematic provisions in the Dam Safety Bill 2021 that needs to be urgently brought to the attention of all those concerned. So, based on the data available from the National Register of Large Dams 2019, there are 5,344 large dams in the country. Of these, 293 dams are over 100 years old and 1,041 are between 50 and 100 years old. While this does not necessitate urgent measures to ensure the safe functioning of these river valley projects, the peculiar way in which the Dam Safety Bill 2019 has been framed needs serious scrutiny. Sir, the bill provides for surveillance, inspection, operation, and maintenance of all specified dams in the country. Specified dams are those which satisfy a few structural criteria. It calls for the establishment of two bodies at national and state levels to formulate and execute policies, resolve conflicts between states, and so on within their respective jurisdictions. The Central Water Commission has noted that the functioning of dam safety organization in various states is subpar and needs urgent intervention. However, the Dam Safety Bill in its current form is replete with many contentious clauses, namely, firstly, sir, subjects such as water supply, irrigation, and canals, embankments, water storage, and water power fall under the state list in the Constitution as per the entry 17. The central government, as per entry 56, can legislate on subjects such as interstate rivers and river valleys only if such legislation has been declared to be in the public interest. This poses a problem as 92% of all specified dams in the country involve more than one state. If the central government were to legislate on such a subject, it would be a clear encroachment of states' sovereignty and hence unconstitutional. Sir, the predecessor of the 2019 bill, the Dam Safety Bill 2010, was introduced in the parliament under Article 252, as pointed out by my colleague here. This article allows the parliament to make laws on subjects in the states list if two or more states pass resolution demanding the passage of such a law. A law so made would only be applicable to those states. Any other state that chooses to adopt the law may do so by passing a resolution. In this case, the two states had passed law requiring dam safety in 2007. So the Dam Safety Bill 2010 had hence come through a constitutional provision and had given the states the power to manage their dams and enact laws on dam safety. The current bill, on the other hand, sir, does not guarantee any such power to the states. It is yet another legislation that seeks to snatch away constitutionally guaranteed power of the states. Ever since the inception of this regime, we have seen how the state's rights have been trampled upon. The union government has been constantly legislating on subjects outside its legal jurisdiction, as was seen in the case of the recently repealed farm laws, for instance. In the case of subjects that fall under the concurrent list, most decisions have been taken unilaterally by the central government with no consultations whatever. Secondly, sir, the provision to have a representative of the Central Water Commission as a member of the NCDS, that is the regulatory body, would mean that the CWC will function both as an advisor and regulator, which is impermissible under the Constitution, according to the Supreme Court. Thirdly, sir, the financial memorandum of this bill states that rupees 47 crores will be spent to set up the authorities and structure. It is completely silent on the flow of funds to the states. This effectively means that the states will have to pay while the center will merely give the directions. Nextly, sir, the National Committee on Dam Safety is to have a 21-member committee. The chairman and 10 people who are nominated by the, who will be nominated by the central government, 7 people from the state who will be nominated again by the central government, and 3 experts who are also to be nominated by the central government. So, sir, all 21 members will be nominated by the central government. This is a classic case of infringement of the state's autonomy. Every single state in which a large dam exists should have the full freedom to nominate the members to the committee as per their wish. Finally, sir, the provision in the bill that allows core functions of the national and state level bodies to be amended through government notification may also not be legally admissible. The Dam Safety Bill 2019 is without doubt unconstitutional and clearly yet another attempt to encroach upon the sovereignty of the states and violates upon the principles of federalism. Hence, I urge the minister to take these rather crucial points into consideration and address the inadequacies in the bill and ensure that it does not violate the constitutional principles before going any further with it. So my colleague here, Mr. Shiva, is here. He had asked for a select committee, sir. We endorse his view, and since it is such a contentious bill, we ask that it should go to a select committee so it can be studied further before it can be brought to the House. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. The next speaker is T.K.S. Elangovan.
Thank you, Honorable Vice Chairman, sir.